So today, as you know, we will be learning about endothermic and exothermic processes and reactions. First, we will be learning these processes and then the reactions related to both of these topics. In the last lecture, we had learned the four types of reactions, that is displacement reaction, double displacement reaction, combination reaction and decomposition reaction. So, and I had told you, I had given you just a bit idea about endothermic and exothermic reactions. So today we'll be learning it in brief and also we'll be seeing its reactions. So let us begin. So first of all, we'll see the meaning of exothermic or endothermic and how are they classified. So heat is absorbed and given away in various processes and reactions. Accordingly, processes and reactions are classified as endothermic or exothermic. Means what it means to say is that during any reaction which takes place, either heat is liberated or heat is absorbed. So according to these criteria, the reaction is divided into either exothermic or endothermic. If heat is liberated, that is, if heat is given out, then the process is said to be exothermic as the heat is being released. And if in order to the reaction to take place, if heat is absorbed, then the process is said to be an endothermic process. So now let us see the processes. So heat from outside is absorbed during some physical changes, for example melting of ice, dissolution of potassium nitrate in water. Therefore these are endothermic. Means from surrounding, from nearby of the body, heat is absorbed during some physical changes. Means when ice melts, from ice it converts to water, so heat is absorbed. So this is known as endothermic process. Now on the other hand, heat is given away during some physical changes, for example formation of ice from water, dissolution of sodium hydroxide into water. See, when ice gets converted, ice is formed from water, the heat in the water is liberated, means it's given out. That's why the water is able to take up the shape of ice. Here the heat is liberated or the heat is given out. So this process is known as exothermic process. In the process of dilution of concentrated sulfuric acid with water, very large amount of heat is liberated. As I told you, for water to get converted to ice means to change its temperature, characteristics, physical appearance, a lot of heat is liberated from the ice. Then only it gets converted into lot of heat is liberated from the water, then only it get converted to ice. As a result, water gets evaporated instantaneously if it is poured into the concentrated sulfuric acid, which may cause an accident. To avoid this, required amount of water is taken in a glass container and small quantity of concentrated sulfuric acid at a time is added with the stirring. Therefore, only a small amount of heat is liberated at a time. Now again, we'll be learning about exothermic and endothermic processes, but here we'll not see the whole exercise, or will not see the whole process. We'll just concentrate on this a single paragraph, which is that during the process of dissolution of KNO3 in water, heat from the surroundings is absorbed and therefore the temperature of the resulting solution is less. The process in which heat is absorbed from outside is called endothermic process. When the solid NaOH is dissolved in water, heat is given out, that is, heat is liberated, and therefore the temperature increases. The processes in which heat are given are called as exothermic process. This I have already taught you. Now, endothermic and exothermic reactions. Now I will explain you exothermic and endothermic with the help of reactions. So there is an exchange of heat in chemical reactions as well. Accordingly, some chemical reactions are exothermic while some are endothermic. During exothermic chemical reactions, heat is given away from reactants. See, during an exothermic chemical reaction, heat is given away from the reactants and are transformed into the products. while during endothermic reactions, heat is either absorbed from the surroundings or has to be supplied continuously from outside. Now we'll see two examples, one of endothermic and another of exothermic. So what does endothermic reaction say? CaCO3, which is calcium carbonate, is in solid form plus heat, means heat is absorbed, gives CaO, means calcium oxide, plus CO2, which is carbon dioxide. So it is an endothermic reaction, as heat is supplied to the reactant and it is being absorbed. Now here, calcium oxide plus H2O, which is CaO plus H2O, gives CaOH twice, which is in aqueous form, plus heat. Here heat is in the products form. Now you remember, if heat is in the reactant side or on the above the arrow, it will be an endothermic reaction, whereas if heat is in the product side, it will be an exothermic reaction. Now let us see the rate of chemical reaction and then we'll conclude our session. So now, what is rate of chemical reaction? Now your chemical reaction takes a specific amount of time to get completed. Now that specific time can be either increased, that is fast enough, or can be decreased, that is slower down. So for these process only, some of the catalysts are used, or these few things are used in order to increase or decrease your rate of chemical reaction. Now let us see. It can be seen from the above examples that some reactions are completed in short time, that is occur rapidly, while some other require long time for completion, that is occur slowly. It means that the rate of different reactions is different. That's why I just told you. Now you just focus on this above part. It says that the same reaction occurs at a different rate on changing the conditions. For example, during water, long time is required for setting milk into curd, while at higher temperature during summer, the rate of setting of milk increases and the curd is formed early. Now let us see the factors which decide the rate of chemical reaction. See, today I will just tell you the factors. Tomorrow we'll be learning more efficiently regarding the factors affecting the rate of chemical reaction. So first one is nature of reactants. Second one is size of the particles of reactants. Third one is concentration of reactants. Fourth one is temperature of the reaction. Whereas the last one is the catalyst. Now I just showed you the five topics which we are going to learn in the next lecture, so you can be prepared so that we can help you out in a better way. So friends, that is it for today. We learned a lot about rate of chemical reactions, exothermic reaction, endothermic reaction, their differentiation, their similarities, etc. So friends, hope you like the video. Share with your family and friends, and also subscribe to our channel. You can put in your doubt below down in the comment box so that we can help you out with your problem. So thanks for watching and bye bye.